Kobe, I'm interested in your spiritual journey. I want to know where you started out spiritually and how your path went.
I don't know. I probably won't find out where I started spiritually until I leave my body. But I'm sure it started a little before I was born. I was 36 hours before I was born, I started to die. Dying became a way of life. It's very crashing boring. By the time I was born, I had cyanosis, brain damage. I was even unattractive, believe it or not. And then I came screaming into the 20th century, and I'd just been in a rage. I'm not sure exactly if I know everything about the rage and why. But I was in a rage, and it's a funny thing because all my life as a little kid, I used to look around at the world and say, this is not the way it's supposed to be. I could not, and I still don't, but as a child, it baffled me even more why people are always hurting each other. I could not understand that. And when I was a kid, I remember I had two heroes. One was Paul Robeson, the other was Mahatma Gandhi. I don't know why, but I just loved these men. And I actually got to meet Paul Robeson, Teddy the fellow. Anyway, it's a whole thing. But it's really part of it. And then a conscious decision was made based on a spiritual experience, but I didn't know it at the time. That's when I started writing.
How old were you then?
At 28. See, I'd spent about four years in a hospital. I had 10 ribs cut out along colossal. Oh.
Why?
At TB during the war. I went to sea when I was 15 during the war.
World War II?
Yeah.
And you were in the
That's
Navy?
That's the only real war, isn't it? Yeah. No, I was a merchant seaman. And I loved going to sea. I paid a price for it.
Why do you get TB at sea?
Well, during the war, there was a lot of TB. Because of stress, because of malnutrition, because of sanitary conditions. Not on the ship, but all through Europe. And just exposed to it. So there was an awful lot of TB in the armed forces during and in Europe during the war.
Mm-hmm. And excuse me for interrupting, but just you said in the womb you had cyanosis?
Yeah.
What is that?
Well, cyanosis is lack of oxygen, you turn blue.
Oh.
The cord was wrapped around my neck for 36 hours. Uh-huh. So by the time I was born, I was, let's just say, brain damaged. Unhappy.
How brain damaged were you?
Oh, I don't know exactly. Just a couple different kinds of brain damage. One is a genetic thing. I don't know what the name of it is, but it's a rage dispenser that inherited from one son, from father to son.
A rage?
Rage, yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah.
I didn't know you could inherit rage.
Well, evidently there is a brain condition that you can inherit.
So do you experience this rage very often?
All the time.
Yeah?
But I don't inflict it on anyone anymore. I'll get in a rage for a second or two, and then I let it go. I allow myself that part of my humanity to just be out of my head for a few seconds because it's the only thing that at times relieves me. I just get overwhelmed with the pain of living. And right now, I haven't felt this bad in so many years.
Why do you feel that?
Oh, there's some things, family things that are going on that have just absolutely devastated me the last few days. Just so devastated. And then my mother went to the hospital last night, and so, she'll be 90 years old, 20 of the month, so, and it's not like a sudden tragedy. She's since I've been bedridden for years. But it's, and it's something I've been expecting all the time. We all have. It's just that, you know, things pile up. You have to do certain things that you know absolutely have to be done. But that doesn't relieve the pain of doing it.
My mother just died in right after Easter, and she was 92, and had not been in good health for many years, and you know, it was time and all of that. But it's just amazing. It doesn't matter what the relationship is with your mother, what kind of, how old they are, if they're ready or not ready. It's always too soon.
That moment, yes.
There's a child, what I found, is the adult of me said, well, you know, she's out of her misery and blah, 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 and all the rationalizations. But the child of me was absolutely devastated.
Yeah, I want my mommy.
I want my mommy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
That's the line.
Right.
Yeah, that's the line.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Yeah, those kind of things I don't think are unavoidable. I think one of the major forms of suffering, as opposed to just pain, but suffering is trying to deny that and deny that part of the human condition that has to experience that kind of grief and pain. And I want my mommy.
So what is the function of suffering?
I think the function, if I'm understanding the word problem, the function of suffering is to let me know that my perception is skewed. What I'm doing is judging natural events in such a way that I am creating suffering within myself. For instance, you have pain over certain conditions, certain situations that occur, and if you just say, okay, here I am, I'm going to experience the pain, you don't suffer. The resistance and the degree of the resistance to the natural phenomenon of life causes man to suffer.
That's what Sarah Goldfarb was trying to avoid.
Right? That's that is the great American dream, is to avoid that.
Yeah.
That's why it'll kill you dead.
Yeah. I kept feeling as I was playing Sarah that if she would just turn off the TV and put down the candy and sit there and say, I'm lonely, and I hurt, that there would be some opportunity for change in life.
Oh. I don't think life ever presents, it's not the right word, but I don't think you can ever encounter a problem in life without life having already given you the answer. I think it's a spiritual impossibility to have a problem without having the answer. But my judgments cloud up everything so the answer can just flow through my consciousness.
Now, I interrupted you. You started to say about a spiritual experience when you were 28.
Well, sadly, I've been given up, as I say, I've been given up for dead about four times in the hospital. And I had just gotten out of the hospital again with asthma, and this time the doctors, I love this, I love the AMA, God bless them all. I was in the hospital, and this so-called specialist came, and he didn't come in the room, he just stood out in the hallway, and he said, there's nothing we can do for you, you don't have any lungs, and you just can't live, go home, sit down and take it easy, and you know, you'll be dead. And he walked away and sent me a bill. I love him. I dearly love the AMA. But you see,
do I detect a note of irony?
I have such a rotten attitude that I refuse to die. Don't tell me what I'm going to do. So I'm still here. But I went home, and I'm living behind a barber shop at the time. And I remember having this experience. Now, at the time, I didn't realize it was a spiritual experience, but that's what it was. And as such, as you know, those experiences are far more real than any experience you can have on this level of consciousness. Just every cell of your soul is boom. And at the time of the experience, you're connected to experience. So, but I didn't know that at the time. It's only in retrospect I understand that. But I knew that someday I was going to die. And it wouldn't be like had been happening, almost dead, and somehow I'd stay alive. But I was going to die. And just before I died, two things would happen. Number one, I would regret my entire life. And number two, I would want to live my life over again, and then I would die. And that terrified me. Oh, what a thought. To live your whole life, whatever it is, 60, 80 years, 135, whatever. And at the end, you look at it and say, I blew it. I blew the whole thing, and then, whoosh, is that. So I had to do something. I had to do something with my life. So I knew I could never go to school. I mean, I finished the ninth grade. I'm not totally without schooling. But that was enough for me to know I just can't take it. So I knew I could never be a composer or anything that required me going to school. But I knew the alphabet. So I figured I could write. See, sometimes distortions and insanity and arrogance, all these things can work to your advantage. You know? I didn't know.
But why writing? Why not painting?
I realize now that I'm a writer. That's why.
Uh-huh.
But I had to come to that conclusion in my own erroneous and serendipitous kind of reasoning, you know?
Uh-huh.
That's what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
I can't draw a straight line. I have no talent. I'm probably the most untalented person that's ever lived. I don't have any natural abilities. None whatsoever.
How can you be a writer and not have natural ability for writing?
By sitting down and writing every day of your life until you've learned how to write.
No, but what I mean is that if you're a writer, isn't one of the things that defines what you are that you are gifted in that direction?
Depends how you're defining it. I have no natural talent. I could never write a letter. I could never draw a line. I was not an exceptional mechanic. I was never an exceptional athlete. No natural talent. I mean natural talent. Like some people pick up a pencil, give them a piece of paper, they draw.
You had a talent they write staying alive.
That, yeah. You know, or they write poems, or they can write lovely letters and mm-hmm. things like that. Nothing. But I had this obsession to do something with my life. I didn't want to waste it. And so I came home every night and wrote. And I went through reams and reams of papers. Like this one part of Last Exit, Trollolaw, it's about 20 pages long. It took me 2.5 years. I just sat and wrote over and over and over, throw it away, write it in. And I got so involved with the people that I created that when I finished the piece of work, I'd be in bed for a week or two. I'd clunk out at the typewriter. You know, I just totally obsessed with doing something with my life.
Now, both Last Exit Brooklyn and Requiem for a Dream are what almost anyone would call very dark pieces. Why are you attracted to the dark?
Now, I suppose that I know more about the darkness than the light. And it's easier to write about the darkness than the light.
Why?
Because I know more about it. And what is the point? See, unless I can relate to the suffering of people, I cannot offer a solution to the suffering. When I was about 8 or 10 years old, I had my first goal, first ambition, was to end the pain in the world. I was serious. I don't think it was just a... I don't know why, but evidently I saw the world filled with pain. And like that's all I saw was people hurting each other, killing each other, beating each other, just pain everywhere, reading about. And then of course, that was during the Depression, and the war came, it got even worse. Things that people don't. And I couldn't understand it as a child. I still don't. Well, maybe I do to some extent. But I'm very familiar with this darkness from an inner point of view, I think primarily because I started dying at such an early age. And also from an outward point of view, of when you have this awareness of anything internally, you perceive that externally. We really do, I believe, create the world that we live in. If I remember correctly, the word I, physical I, the Sanskrit root and the Hebrew root, I believe, is ayin, meaning fountain. In other words, this is not an organ that's receiving vibrations from what's out there and going through the brain and interpreting. It's a projector. We project it. So the world that I live in, I'm projecting. So it seems to me that if I'm have such an inner awareness of darkness, that's what I'm going to perceive, is darkness. So I became, not consciously, but I became obsessed with learning how to write and learning how to get as deep into the darkness as possible and then bring it back. And say, okay, here's the problem. I'm not giving you any answer, but here is the problem. Here's the darkness. Now, what do you want to do about it? That's not consciously what I was about, but that's kind of what I ended up doing. Because the first four books are pathological without any catharsis, any relief, any answer. But if what has happened is something very, very amazing. During these years, I've talked with thousands of people who have gotten letters. And there is one thing, one word, that everyone uses with reference to my work, and that's compassion. And they found within himself the compassion and ability to not judge the people that ordinarily they would judge into the grave. Suddenly they have compassion for these people, which is extraordinary. And that's not what I set out to do. But evidently that's a result, because I hear that from so many people. So the first four books were an attempt to really look at the darkness in as many different ways as I could. Then I wanted to not only go from the darkness to the light, but to show how you get from the darkness to the light. See, I've never wanted to just tell a story. I wanted to put the reader through an emotional experience. And I believe the reason for that is that I've always been a frustrated teacher and a frustrated preacher. And I've known that. So I'm very consciously do I work to keep that out of my writing. Because I believe that the writer has no business being there, that the ego has to go. And that's certainly something you understand as an artist. Saying the ideal is to get rid of you, right? And I believe I don't have the right to put me, the ego, between the people in the story and the reader. They should have an interrelationship and experience each other. Because if you really want to teach, you have to do it emotionally. What is it? The intellect doesn't, it can get a whole bunch of information, but it doesn't turn it into wisdom. And it's wisdom that we need if we're going to save ourselves, our souls, and this bloody thing here. We need wisdom.